I smell cappuccino. What time is it? Let's see. I feel like I overslept. What? 7 weeks? It's been 7 weeks. Hey, voice, wake up. We overslept. I don't know what happened to the sleep pods, but we overslept. Voice, you're awake?
Yeah. I just woke up a few minutes before you. There must have been a problem with the sleep and recharge pod bay interface. Yeah, that's the ticket.
All right, whatever. Never mind. Let's go. We got to get this show on the road. We are way behind. Go ahead. Start us off.
On today's episode of the Atari 7800 Game by Game podcast, we will be covering CX-7863 Mat Mania Challenge and CX-7868 Planet Smashers. According to some reports, CX-7864 was supposed to be tubing, where you silly humans float down a river throwing cans. What wasteful creatures you are.
Hey guys, welcome back to the Satellite of Pro. This is the Atari 7800 Game by Game podcast. My name is Phil. I'll be your host today. And today I thought I'd start off just by telling you guys how I clean my cartridge video games. So I know it's kind of like one of those things where everyone kind of has their own style. I'll just share you mine and I will leave it up to you how you decide to clean your games. And if you have a different way of cleaning your games, send it in. Let me know. I'd be curious to find out. So I heard about people cleaning video games with Q-tips and rubbing alcohol. But actually, what I tended to use for the longest time was Windex. I find Windex is really good with cleaning the cartridges. So I actually have a little half-size bottle, water bottle, that I emptied out. I pour some Windex in there. And what I do is I grab two Q-tips and I dip them in together. So it's kind of like, you know, double the Q-tips, double the surface area. And I just rub them against the cartridge. What do you call those things? Those metal things. Contacts. That's it. Contacts. I rub them against the contacts, both sides, back and front. And then I use the other side of the Q-tip, the dry side, to dry them off. And I let them dry maybe a little bit sometimes. And if some of the cotton from the Q-tips gets stuck, I will pull them out with a little pair of tweezers I have. Now, I did run into some problems with some games. So what I ended up doing with some games is I actually tried using the rubbing alcohol. And what I found is that for some games, the Windex works best, and for some, the rubbing alcohol works best. There was a time when I was just using the rubbing alcohol. I think I was using like a 90% proof. And I would, and it was working really good. But then I get a game that was just giving me trouble, usually Activision games for some reason, switch over to Windex, pops on. It works great. Sometimes it's just the opposite. The Windex was working good, except one game's giving it trouble. And then I try the rubbing alcohol and that works great. So for me, I use both. Now I know there's like people who think that the rubbing alcohol is too potent. It could damage the contacts in the cart. And there's some people who say that actually the ammonia in Windex will hurt your cartridges, but I think if you dry them off, you'll probably be fine. I've used them. I've never had a game that got ruined by doing it, but I've had a lot of games that have come back to life by using these methods. Of course, you could always, you know, do the old NES blow on the cartridge things, but then the moisture from your breath could end up on the contacts and corrode it as well in the long run. So that's just the way I clean them. If I'm having a really tough trouble with the game, I can try Brasso sometimes. I'll use the Brasso and then I'll use Windex or the rubbing alcohol after I use the Brasso. That's only for like extreme cases. I've heard some people, they like to use erasers. Some people like to use a very light sandpaper in really hard cases. I don't know if I've ever gone that far myself, but that's just what I do. So I switch between rubbing alcohol and the Windex. I have them in little half-size water bottles, and I just use two Q-tips at a time. So that's what I do. If you do something else, let me know what you do and what you find great success with. I know that I think it's like a contact cleaner you can buy. People used to buy it from Radio Shack or something like that, that people say is really good as well, but maybe that'll help you. All right, do it at your own risk, but maybe it will help you. All right, there you go. That's the intro. Let's go on to today's games. Let's get right to it.
What's up, guys? Nick Stevens here from the Genesis Gems Podcast, and you are listening to the Atari 7800 Game by Game Podcast. For more on the Genesis Gems Podcast, head on over to www.genesisgemspodcast.com. Catch you later.
Matt Mania Challenge. Really? Need I say more?
Okay, real quick history on Matt Mania. Matt Mania Challenge is based on a combination of Technos' arcade games, 1985's Matt Mania and 1986's Mania Challenge, which allowed two players to face each other, which the previous game did not. Matt Mania was followed up, was a follow-up itself to 1984's Tag Team Wrestling, which would later get ported to the NES. Matt Mania Challenge on the 7800 has a copyright year of 1990. The box art, I think if you're a wrestling fan, you can kind of understand what they're going for. It appears to be Shawn Michaels jumping on a guy who at first I thought was some Back to the Future John Cena kind of guy, because he kind of looks like John Cena, whose face is like everywhere. If you know a kid who likes wrestling, they like John Cena. But upon further inspection, I think actually the guy's supposed to resemble Brutus the Barber Beefcake. That's my kind of idea there. I don't know for sure, but Brutus looks like he's in fear as Shawn Michaels is about to punch him in the face. What's interesting is they must have been a tag team that broke up, because they both have matching armbands. They're both pink with kind of the leopard spots on them. And Shawn Michaels, this is for you old-time WWF fans. He appears to be wearing El Matador's pants. That's Tito Santana. Later in his time in the WWF was El Matador, a bullfighter. And he wore these kind of green pants. And that's what we see here with like a pink belt, because neon was all the rage. In the background, you could see some spectators. They're all gasping. Or actually, they all have that look like a doctor is coming up to them and saying to them, "Hey, say ah," because they don't look like they're excited. They just have their mouths wide open in the shadows in the background. On the back, it says the Ultimate Challenge. And you have two screenshots that almost look like they were taken back to back. And the first one, you have one of the wrestlers with the guy in the headlock. The other guy's in the headlock. And the other one looks like he's doing a throw or a body slam. But other than that, everything else on the screens look almost identical. Where the ref is standing, the ring, the backgrounds, they almost look identical. So in my opinion, this was a bad choice. I think they should have put the title screen on one of these screenshots. Anyways, let's go ahead and read the back of the box. Wouldn't you know it? You drew Bruno the Sledge, 5-time champion and all-around bad guy, as your first opponent in your quest for the elusive Atari Wrestling Federation Championship belt. Ever since he lost his title to Eric the Flaxen Saxon, Bruno's been terrorizing the AWF circuit. Bruno the Sledge glares at you with his one remaining eye. When the bell rings, he charges like a man insane, just before the impact of his 386-pound body, which you'll never see a wrestler in this game that looks like he weighs that much. You step aside and raise your elbow. Perfect elbow smash. Bruno falls to the mat. You get him in a headlock, but his shaved head slips free. Then you see it, the famous Bruno Sledge Eye of Terror, the look of death. You're in trouble now. Matt Mania Challenge provides all the thrills and spills of professional wrestling. Lies. Do you have what it takes to survive brain busters and pile drivers? If you have the skills, the championship belt will be yours. Lies. And at the bottom it says, winners don't use drugs. And it doesn't tell you how many players, or that's for the Atari 7800 Pro Series systems. It's interesting because it looks like one of the more older style boxes, but it was one of the later releases. You have a 6-page folded manual. Of course, you have the red, white, and slightly pinkish red ink of the cover art for the front page. Inside the manual, it says, after months of practice, you made it to the final round of the Atari Wrestling Federation Championships. Now you stand gloriously in the ring, sure to make enough dough from this title bout to retire to a farm in Vermont, if you can survive. The announcer, a little man with a voice like a muffler on a half-dead pickup truck, reaches for the overhead microphone. He announces the name of the champion, the 394-pound mountain, who hasn't lost a match since Troy was sacked. The crowd roars. Then, between giggles and snickers, the announcer spits out your name. Your fans cheer. your fan cheers. Oh, it's just one fan. I'm sorry. I thought it was fans. It's plural. It's just one. Your singular fan. Your fan cheers as the Undertaker edges his way toward your corner and pulls out his measuring tape. And Undertaker is not supposed to be capitalized. It's just a random Undertaker, not the wrestler dude. But you know you can do it. You can do it. After all, you've made a science of the flying body press. So what if your opponent outweighs you by 286 pounds? So you're only like 108 pounds? Holy smokes. Well, I guess if you were a kid, that might be accurate if you're like grade school or middle school when you played this. The opening bell clangs as the bout begins. The champion lumbers towards you like a freight train gone berserk. This is not going to be easy. Do you have the guts and the skill to defeat the madman of the mats? Will you retire to that farm or spend the rest of your life in intensive care at the local hospital? You know, because all kids dream about retiring to a farm in Vermont. It's too late to back out now, so give it your best shot. Good luck. You'll need it. Wouldn't it be funny if it was Barnyard you retired to, and now you have to help your pop fight off the vermin in Barnyard. All right, so then we just have your standard how to start the game and all that stuff. You can select one or two players. If you selected a one-player game, then the difficulty level selection option displays along the bottom of the screen. Move the corner controller in any direction to select the difficulty level, either easy, medium, or hard. So gone is novice, standard, expert, and intermediate. Then press the fire button again to begin a match, or if you selected a two-player game, the match begins once you press the fire button. Note, in a two-player game, you don't select the difficulty level. It's only when you play against a computer that you must select the computer's skill level. If you ever want to return to the selection screen to change the game options, press select to reset the game. Press reset, pause, of course, pauses the game. Playing the game. Map Mania Challenge simulates a series of wrestling matches between either two players or one player in the computer. Wrestlers compete against challengers for a score. The top of the screen displays each wrestler's current score with the time remaining in the match. The object of the match is to either pin your opponent for the count of three, keep him out of the ring for a 20 count, or outscore him. And I think that was that WCW rules or something, because I grew up watching WWF before they had the E, and it was always a 10 count. So when you heard about these 20 counts, that was like lesser promotions. Each match lasts 3 minutes. Your points accumulate throughout the match. If neither wrestler is pinned for the count by the end of the match, the player with the highest number of points wins. Two-player games consist of up to 3 matches. If one player is pinned, the game ends and the title screen appears. If no one is pinned by the end of the third match, the player with the highest score wins. In a one-player game, if you pin or outscore your computer opponent, you will move on to the next match. If the computer wins, the game ends and the title screen appears. By the way, when you move on to the next match, it's the exact same match with the exact same wrestler over and over and over again. This game makes it sound like you can win a belt, but you will never win a belt. There is no tournament. It's just two wrestlers who just fight themselves. You can't select a different wrestler, and they both look fairly generic. We'll get to that later, but yeah, this game makes it sound like, hey, you could win a belt. You can face this 300, almost 400-pound dude, and you're outweighed, and then you get these two wrestlers who look about the size of just about any jobber in the WWF from the 1980s. Use a controller to maneuver the fighters. When the wrestlers are close to each other, they go into grapple position. Wrestling moves. Map Mania Challenge offers several bone-crushing moves designed to drop your opponent for the count. The available moves at any given time depend on the current situation. For example, if you have your opponent in a headlock, press the right button to perform a pile driver, or while running across the ring, move the controller in any direction and press the right button to clothesline your opponent. Below is a table listing the possible moves and how to make them. So I'll tell you all these moves, but to be honest with you, when I played, I wasn't thinking about the table. I was just kind of, not exactly button mashing, but I was just trying to, well, kind of button mash, but I wasn't like just rapidly hitting them. I was just seeing what happened. So the basic moves, your controller moves you around the ring. You press both buttons to run, left button to punch, right to kick, and to climb a post, you do the controller up. When you're running, if you want to do a shoulder jab, you do the left button. A flying kick is the right. A side kick, you have to move the controller to the left while pushing the left button, and a clothesline is controller to the right while pushing the right button. In the grapple, you can headlock with the right or left button. When your opponent is in a headlock, you could do a hammer throw with the left button, a pile driver with the right button, or an overhead slam with the controller to the left and the left button, if I'm reading this correctly. When you're in a headlock, you can knee drop with the left button and back drop with the right. after the opponent is hammer thrown off the rope. So I guess when they say hammer throw, they're just whipping them to the ropes. You could do a flying kick with the right button, a crouch with the left button, elbow with the controller left button, and a clothesline with the controller right button. From the post, that's when you're staying on the top of the turnbuckle, you could do a knee drop with the left button and the backdrop with the right button. And when they say backdrop, I think what they mean is you just land on your back on them. I'm trying to remember. When I'm playing the game, I'm not thinking about the moves. I'm just wrestling, you know. And sometimes with these manuals, they mislabel things. Like if you're a fan of wrestling, you know the backdrop is not something you usually do from the top rope. At least that's not what people call it. And while the opponent is down, you can pick them up with the left or pin them with the right. If your opponent throws you out of the ring, you have 20 seconds to get back in the ring. Move your wrestler in front of the ring and climb through the ropes by moving the controller up. If one wrestler is thrown out of the ring, the other wrestler can jump over the left or right side of the ring. Wrestlers can fight outside the ring, but they must be back in before the 20 count. Strategy. It takes quick reactions and good timing to be a champion. It also takes a different game to be a champion. Learn to anticipate your opponent's move and react accordingly. Wear your opponent down with the repeated punches. Don't try to pin your opponent every time he hits the floor. Pick him up and destroy him. This increases your total points. Besides, it's more fun to bash heads than to gain a quick victory. By the way, there's no life meter or health meter, so you're kind of pinning by feel. You're kind of trying to figure out, because if you try and pin early on and you didn't do much, you might not get him down, but there's no clear sign when your opponent's worn down enough for a pin, at least not to me. Learn how to use the ropes and the post. Throw your opponent against the ropes. When he bounces back, give him a quick clothesline or a similar move. If he hits the floor in the right place, climb to the post and drop on him. By the way, I found it very hard to do top rope moves on the computer. I basically gave up on those. That might be fun against a human opponent, but then again, they might get up in time too. If your opponent has you against the ropes and he's beating the tar out of you, press both buttons to run. Of course, your opponent will be in the way, but you may have a chance to escape and turn things around. Remember, pain is good. When the other guy feels it, don't go easy on your opponent. Mercy may be sportsmanlike, but who wants to be nice? So I guess you're a heel. All right, points. If you pick up or punch your opponent, you get 50 points. Clothesline, hammer throws, kicks give you 100. Elbow is 200 points. Flying kick, overhead slam, I guess that's just a body slam. Running clothesline, shoulder jab, side kick, all 300. The crouch is 400. The manual's not labeled in a way I recognize. I think the crouch is when you, like, you know, put your head down and then you throw the guy over your body. Backdrop from a headlock or a knee drop will get you 800 points. So will a pile driver or running flying kick. Backdrop from the post or knee drop from the post is 1,000, and pinning gets you 4,000 points, and then you repeat it. All right. Graphically speaking, you start the game. You have a nice title screen. It says Mania Challenge. You have a guy in these little green trunks, and he's giving a headlock to a guy. It's like the guy is right in his belly. You can't see his face at all. And the other guy looks like he's totally losing control, and he's wearing white trunks. And there's a little bit of spotlight coming down. And some stars around Matt Mania Challenge, making it look almost patriotic as well. When the game starts, okay, so the crowd is kind of interesting. They animate a little bit. Their heads move. I mean, there's a lot of repeated people in the crowds. The ring itself is very kind of almost pastel-y. You got a lot of red, white, and blue. The ropes are red. The turnbuckles are white, and some of the ring is white. The ring floor is a pastel blue, because nothing says tough like pastel blue, and a darker blue around the apron and the guardrails as well. The referee looks different. He has no face, but you could tell he's a ref, has a nice little French-style hat on. And the two wrestlers look, like I said, like a bunch of jobbers. One's wearing red trunks with red boots, and the other one's wearing blue trunks with blue boots. And so you got the Republican Democratic Atari sports thing going on that was almost in every sport game, the red versus the blue. And that's about it. I mean, these are two generic wrestlers, which is very, very kind of sad, because you know, if you grew up watching WWF in the 80s, it was all about colorful, bigger than life superstar wrestlers. And this looks like wrestlers who came from the 50s. And even in the 50s, they had these guys who showboated, the Gorgeous Georges of the world and the Bruno Sammartinos later on. And these guys just look so generic. If you win a match, you get your hand raised and that's about it. It restarts. There is no belt, a screen or anything like that. The music and sounds are terrible. There's this out-of-tune song that plays during the match. The sounds aren't that great. It's one of these games you just want to turn off the music. I'll let you be the judge of that. This is a late release, slightly rare game. Atari Age gives it a rarity 4, Digital Press a 3. I'd go with the 4. There's 3 external reviews at Atari Age. The high was 62%. The low was 30% for an average score of 44%. There was no high score club challenge. This would be probably hard to do a high score club. At the time of my research, which honestly was quite a while ago, there was only basically new copies available. It's one of these old releases like Jinx where you're going to find a lot of new copies, but not much other than that. And new copies were going for $14 to $25. I didn't own this growing up. I probably sold my Atari when I was playing Sega Genesis by the time this thing came out. But I think I bought it from O'Shea's when they were doing their clearancing out around the year 2000. And then I got it later on as well. So it's one of these later releases that you don't have to pay a lot of money to get. So that's Map Mania Challenge. Let's move on to Planet Smashers.
Hey, this is Willie.
And this is RK.
From the 5200 Super Podcast.
Hey, this is Ferg. What am I doing here?
What are you doing here?
We like listening to the 5200 Game by Game Podcast.
I know I do, especially when I'm not down at the river wringing out my 7800 circuit board,
beating it against the rock.
Have you played Atari today?
Planet Smashers. Sounds like my type of work. I wonder if they are hiring.
Planet Smashers is a vertically scrolling space shooter from the year 1990. It was programmed by somebody named James Zalewski. I really don't know anything much about him beyond that, but hey, give him credit because he deserves it. He's one of the few guys who gets credit for Atari 7800 games because it's hard to find out who programmed these games many times. All right, the box art has a planet exploding on the bottom right by the little new sticker, and Planet Smashers kind of flying at you. It's a great font, but it's like flying at you in like a simulated 3D, and you have 3 kind of generic space fighters all zooming in towards the Planet Smashers sign. Honestly, they kind of look like a combination of spaceships and mosquitoes getting ready to suck the blood out of Planet Smashers logos, because they have like these like spearheads at the end, and they're going right at it, and then there's just dark space in behind that. The back of the box says, "Earthlings beware, alien starship attack. It's an alien ambush from a far-out galaxy. Alien Planet Smashers are coming to obliterate planet Earth. You must suit up and head off the invasion. Your starship is equipped with capable blasters, but you can earn mega weapons and devastating firepower. The alien motherships are the ultimate challenge. With colorful full-screen graphics and awesome sound effects, blast off and blast away. It's only the fate of the planet at stake." And planet is capitalized, so I guess the name of the planet is planet. So welcome to planet. But they did say planet Earth, but they capitalized the P. So it's not just Earth, it's planet Earth. His first name is planet, the last name is Earth. For use with the 7800 system and controller. So only one bullet point there, another one of the mosquito ships on the bottom flying out. And then you have 3 screenshots. 2 of them are against 2 different bosses. And one of them in the center is just a standard screenshot from in between one of the levels. So at least they included some different scenery. All right, let's go on, and the manual, 6 pages folded again. Once again, the cover is basically black and white, not really any red here, same as the box art. While exploring a far-off region of the cosmos, your best friend's starship was ambushed by hostile aliens from a remote galaxy. Am I the only one who, when you hear the word, like, remote galaxy, you're thinking of, like, a television remote, like a never mind. These hostile aliens have informed Earth that they are sending a crack intergalactic invasion force, the Planet Smashers, to take over your planet. Dun, dun, dun. You know that with a name like the Planet Smashers, these guys are not going to leap at a chance to a vacation in Geneva and talk peace. These vicious aliens murdered your friend. They are intending to pillage your planet and enslave your fellow humans. Besides, they're really ugly, because that's a good reason to beat up and destroy a civilization, is because they're ugly. How shallow are you? Come on. You can't wait to take your starship out to meet these ill-begotten space cadets. You can't allow even one planet smasher to reach the Earth. Well, you're probably going to allow at least one. Okay, so it just tells you how to set it up. Switch on your console. The Planet Smashers title screen appears. If you do not touch the controller, the high score screen appears. It does keep high scores, but it doesn't save them. Listening to 10 top scores, press the fire button to continue. You can select one or two players. Moving the controller up or down, but I believe it's alternating. And then you have a difficulty level, either easy or hard, and that's it. In easy mode, the capsules drop down more slowly than in hard mode. The enemies are slower to move and shoot, and the warp capsule colors needed to progress to the next level are the same every time you play. In hard mode, the enemies are faster. The warp capsule colors needed to progress to the next level are randomly generated every time you play. In two-player Planet Smashers, each player can select a different difficulty level. So that's kind of cool. And then you press a button when you confirm it. Of course, you can pause and reset as well. Playing the game. Planet Smashers is an exciting vertically scrolling space shooter. You must expertly maneuver your ship to avoid deadly alien fire. Blast away with speed and accuracy to destroy seven waves of mutant invaders before they get a chance to destroy the Earth. I'm sorry, it's planet Earth, you forgot. While you do battle with these vicious creatures in their home galaxies, the Earth will have more time to build shields against alien attack. Begin by commanding the first of your four sleek starships. Isn't it great that you have four starships and that if one blows up, you can like just jump out and get in the other one? You can maneuver your starship within the lower half of the game screen. So you can't move throughout the whole game screen, but it's not just right or left. So think kind of like Centipede. Centipede's kind of like that. Moving the controller moves your craft right, left, up, or down. You can also go a little diagonal, you know. Press left fire button to shoot. Without shields, each starship will be destroyed with only one hit from enemy fire or one collision with an alien craft. Learn to dodge quickly to protect your starship. The game ends after your last starship is destroyed. But you do get more, like, I think, I'm pretty sure that you, it's not just a one hit and done, because you had like a shield gauge. So You have your shields up, but as you get shot, you lose some of your shields, but you can regain your shield. So it is true, if your shields are completely down, you'll blow up, but it's not like one shot will blow you up in this game. Score points for each alien starship you destroy. Shoot alien cargo vessels to release valuable items. Move underneath release items to pick them up and upgrade your ship. Be careful, some released items are destroyed if you shoot them. You'll need the warp capsule to speed on to the end of the current galaxy in your fight to keep the alien horde from reaching Earth. Or you just keep traveling until you reach the end of the level. So the warp sends you to the boss at the end of the level. Otherwise, you just keep flying away until you get to him. So either way you'll get to him, you don't need to warp. After surviving regular alien attacks, you must destroy the alien leader of each galaxy. The leaders are tough to destroy and have killer attack abilities. Your final encounter will be with the dictator of the Planet Smashers, a nasty video game alien. He's actually a video game alien who will put your most horrible nightmares to shame. So this is kind of like Pixels all of a sudden. After you have destroyed the evil dictator, the high score screen appears. If you manage to beat one of the high scores listed, your score will appear on the high score screen. In two-player Planet Smashers, each player must successfully complete the game before the Earth can be saved. Screen. The game takes place on the action screen. The status bar displays the information. It shows you a little graphic. So you have from right to left, you have the warp all the way on the right. So this displays the colored warp capsules you've collected. Empty warp boxes flash briefly when needed warp capsules are collected out of sequence. So what happens is when you pick up one of these colored, there's these color crystals that these enemy ships will sometimes let go of. When you shoot them, they change colors. If you get the right color, it'll fill up the order. So like you have to get an order. So let's say it's blue, red, and yellow. So if you get the blue, you'll fill up the first slot. But if you get yellow, which is like the, let's say it's the last one, then the last one will flash yellow, but it won't count because you have to get them in order. I hope that makes kind of sense. It makes sense when you play it. Next to that, you have the number of ships you have left. Then the range is kind of like a gauge. It's a meter that tells you how close you are to the galaxy leader. The shield shows you how many shields you have remaining. The cloak shows you how many cloaks you have remaining. And they'll tell us later that you do the cloak by doing the right bar and it turns you invisible so the enemies don't shoot at you and hit you as easily. The earth shield, now we're getting closer to the right. I'm sorry, I was going from left to right. Did I say right to left? Left to right. So I'm almost to the right side. The earth shield displays the status of the earth's protective shield. Earth shield status will decrease with every alien ship and leader you let slip past you. So if you're fighting a boss and you don't defeat him, he slips past you, it takes away from the earth shield. If the earth shield status is zero, your reserve ships are destroyed and your game is over. And then you have your score all the way to the right. Items, the following capsules are released from destroyed alien cargo ships. Move directly under them, underneath falling capsules to pick them up. And again, you can blow them up, so you have to kind of stop shooting when you're close to them or kind of back into them is what I kind of did. So the weapon capsule increases the fire, and that's a W. It increases the firepower of your ship's weapons. There are 10 levels of weapon capsules. You begin the game with basic firepower, which means you must press the fire button each time you wish to fire one round. So it wears on the thumb. You'll want to use a rapid fire like Sega Genesis controller if you can. Weapon capsules give you automatic rapid fire. So the first time you get a power up, it's from then on out, it's rapid fire. Hold down the fire button and your weapon will fire repeatedly. Each level will increase the rapid fire speed. So it's one of these things where it's like you get an upgrade and your shot is more powerful. Then you get another upgrade and it's not as powerful, but now it spreads into two and then it becomes more powerful. And then it spreads into three and then it becomes more powerful and so on and so forth for 10 different levels. Now, when you die, you lose two of the weapon upgrades. And it seemed to me that most levels you could only upgrade your weapon twice per level. Like there's a ceiling, so you can't get powered up within the first world. You can only power up so much and then the game will stop giving you weapon upgrades. So it really helps you out if you don't die and you can keep on the weapon upgrades, because in the later levels, if you're without those upgrades, it becomes really hard. It's almost, you have multiple lives in this game, but you almost have to beat it in one or two lives. The shield capsule is an asset, protects your ship from a single hit from enemy fire or impact with an enemy vessel, and the impact or hits can destroy your shield. You can store up to 6 of them. The cloaking capsules are the Cs. They make your starship invisible for 20 seconds, but be careful. Just because they can't see you doesn't mean make you invulnerable to stray lucky shots. You can collect and store up to 6 of them and activate them by pushing the right button. But again, these are hard to collect. You're not going to get 6 in the first level. And then the galaxy warp capsules, I told you about these. So when playing, let's see what it says. Each galaxy has 3 color codes. When playing the easy level planet, each level's 3 color code sequence will be the same every time you play that level. In the hard level Planet Smashers, each time the 3 color code sequence is randomly generated. So I guess you could find a guide. I don't know of one, but there is a guide. But I don't really pay much attention to these, because if I try to go out of my way to get them, I'm more likely to die. So I just try and make my way through the level. And if I accidentally warp, you warp. So if you get all 3 colors in a row in the right order and the right colors, you'll just go right to the final boss once you clear the last enemy on that screen after you get all 3. And then there's an extra ship capsule, which looks like a spaceship. It gives you an extra ship. But this cargo is so precious, the aliens have protected with a dangerous trap. The cargo capsule contain the extra ship is released. It's sometimes charged with the deadly energy that will destroy your ship. If you attempt to pick up the capsule, it will destroy your ship. So it goes back and forth. So when it's a ship, if you touch it, you get an extra ship. But if it turns, I think it's just like a death head, a skull thing. If you pick it up, then your ship is destroyed. But again, this is not a game where you get to use your extra ships all the time. It's almost a game, like I said, where you don't want to lose lives. You just want to beat it on one or two. And I haven't even beat the game. Scoring, enemy bombs give you 25 points, cargo ships 100, fighters 300, bombers 500, rammers 500, and the bosses' guns 1,000, and the bosses themselves give you 5,000. So the bosses are comprised of like different segments, so like at least like 5 segments of boss. So there might be one boss shooting 5 different bullets at you, and you defeat one part of him. You shoot him enough times, you defeat one part, and now he's only shooting 4 bullets at you, and so on and so forth. At the title screen, you have a nice graphic of a planet exploding and Planet Smashers in the kind of 3D font coming at you. And then you start the game. Most of the game is, I'll be honest, it's kind of bland. There's only a few kind of enemies, Everyone's kind of small. Your ship looks more like a plane than it does a spaceship because of the way it was drawn. It almost kind of looks like a Christmas tree top or two. Look at a picture. It'll kind of make sense. Almost looks like a futuristic angel or kind of like the Ball Blazer ship with wings. But it's bland backgrounds for the most part. There's asteroids constantly coming down the screen that, again, you're supposed to shoot those as well so they don't take out Earth's shield. But I focus mainly on the enemies. And, I mean, it's like I said, it's kind of bland. You could tell what everything is, but it's black background and the enemies, everything's gray. That's the deal. Everything in this game is gray. The rocks are gray. The enemies are gray with a little bit of color here and there. But there's just a lot of gray and black. The bosses are kind of neat looking, I think, especially some of the later ones. But again, everything's just kind of gray. If you do lose the game, there's a nice screenshot that tells you that you just lost the world. Music and sounds. There's a nice kind of opening theme. It's not great, but it's nice. I liked it. But the sound effects when you play the game, there's no music as you play the game, they can be grating. It's the kind of game where when I'm playing, I get in the zone, I don't pay attention. But it's the kind of game that my wife would say, can you turn that down? It's kind of annoying. So I'll let you listen to that here. I do have some actually cheats, some hints. I haven't tried these yet, so hopefully these work. Hidden credits and invincibility mode. Set the left difficulty switch to the right position, right difficulty to the left. Hold the pause button and power the console on. Release the pause button and wait for the high score screen to appear. Wait for the fourth best score to appear. Then simultaneously, you must set the left difficulty switch to the left position and the right to the right. If done correctly, the text phrase... The text Planet Smashers, programmed by James V. Zalewski, DataFast Computer Services 1989 should appear, and hidden invincibility mode should be active. So that sounds pretty cool. I might try that because I've not been able to get to the end of the game. Let me tell you the ending if you want a spoiler alert. Here it is. Scoot ahead 60 seconds. But basically, if you beat the game... It's one of these cheap things where it says, you've saved the planet, but they went down to Earth and now they're taking over as these zombie aliens. And to help protect them, go play Alien Brigade. And if you play Alien Brigade, it'll say, you've saved the planet. And now they're attacking us from outer space. So go play Planet Smashers. So no matter which game you play, it'll point you to the other game to continue. So you could get caught in an infinity loop. So there you go. All right, the rarity. Atari Age gives it 5. Digital Press gives it 3. I'll give Atari Age the 5, definitely. This was one of the last games I found when I was collecting all of them. As far as the external reviews go, it looks like I have, what's this? 1 for 40%, 1 for 60, 1 for 65, for an average score of 55%. So it wasn't that highly rated. The High Score Club at Atari Age on Easy, Gorfi has a high score of 776,175, and Oyama family on Hard got 1,226,300 points, and he had a video with that one. On eBay, loose copies were going $23 to $26, and there was one complete copy that was going for $50. I did not own this growing up, but when I got my first Atari Flashback, which was modeled after the 7800, I did play this game a little bit. And one of the reasons why I wanted to get the Flashback was because I could play a 7800 game I never played before. Now, it has been probably around 10 years since I played that thing. I need to get it out. And before this podcast is over, I'm really hoping I get it out, play it, and I can tell you. I do remember it was NES on the chip, and some games like Desert Falcon were terrible on the Flashback. And overall, there's not a lot of people who have high regards for the Flashback 1. Flashback 2 gets a lot of high regard, but of course it doesn't have any Atari 7800 games on it. Atari Magazine briefly mentioned these games once in issue 2. There was a little blurb about Map Mania coming to the 7800 with a single screenshot that looks even more bland because it looks, this must have been a work in progress. It's missing the crowd in the background. It's just white. So it even looks more bland than the other one. And then in issue 3, the final issue, there was a preview for Planet Smashers in the preview section, a little paragraph, but there was no screenshot of that one there. All right, guys, those are the games. Now it's time for listener feedback.
Greetings, Earth people. It's me again, IC Robots, from the Toys R Us Report, and you are listening to the Atari 7800 Game-by-Game Podcast with your host, the No-Swear Gamer. What is an Atari 7800? Well, it's like a 2600, but almost 3 times better. Enjoy the show.
And now it's time for listener feedback. You can send your text or MP3 audio submission to Atari7800podcast@aol.com.
Okay, I actually asked for feedback at the forums over at Atari.io, which is a really cool Atari retro gaming site. Not just Atari, but anything, but there is a lot of Atari focus on that. I figured I'd try them out there because they're doing this high score squad thing, and they just did one. Well, it was about a month or so ago on Planet Smashers, and because a lot of people played Planet Smashers, I said, hey, what do you guys think of these games? So Rick R. said, I never played Map Mania, but Planet Smashers, I'd give it a rating, a solid. And by the way, I have a system of 4 ratings. Best is Hall of Fame. That's a top 5 game on the system. Then comes Salad. Then comes Meh. And then comes Trash for a bottom 5 game on the system. Anyways, he says he gives it a solid. There's little more to it than initially meets the eye. I like the method of shooting the jewels in the right color order to get the boss to appear. That adds a bit of complexity to an otherwise simple game. I also like how fast it is with no flicker at all. On the downside, the bosses seem way too hard for me. And yes, the bosses are very hard. And then going on, let's see. DeLorean says, my first thought is that Map Mania Challenge is missing the personality of Fight Night. Would have been fun to do a lot more with the wrestlers and give them more vivid personalities to make the game stand out. I totally agree. And actually, I think if they would have combined the graphics of, what was that, Title Match Pro Wrestling with the control of Map Mania Challenge, it would have been a much better game. Okay, let's see. And DeLorean went on later and said, I never played Map Mania in the arcade, but I remember Map Mania Challenge being kind of lame. Like, they could have done more with the characters to give you more to root for. Oh yeah, I like Action Jackson, he's the man, or Macho Eddie is going to drop the macho elbow, or something more colorful like that. Totally agree there. Radio Poultry says Planet Smashers was a meh game for me at first, but after getting through a few levels on hard difficulty, I think it's more in the solid category. With so much randomness in the game, you can't rely on memorization at all. You have to think on your feet. I do wish there was more variety in the enemies, though. Agree there. Lost Dragon says, ironically, both of these were reviewed in the same issue of Raz, which I think is only a UK press review I ever saw them in. And I think he's over in the UK. Map Mania Challenge pulled at 81%. Wow. Criticism put on animation, sprites seeming to glide, and some difficult moves to pull off. And a little way of music. I thought the animation was okay, but it was just bland characters. Planet Smashers received a 76% score, worth a look, but reviewer found the gameplay unoriginal and repetitive. Not sure if that helps. It sure does. Now let's go to Atari Age, where I asked the same thing in the forums over there. So Toilet Tune says, Map Mania? Meh. This isn't the best game of the genre, and this type of game doesn't age well. Planet Smashers, and I think that's true. A lot of wrestling games from the 80s just did not age well at all. Planet Smashers is solid. Yeah, it's another 2D space shooter, but it does have some substance. If you let enemies get by, they will weaken the Earth's shield. There's the color-coded thingies that let you warp ahead if you figure out the code. I call it a top 10, almost top 5, so not Hall of Fame status, but close. Wow. Drac is back. Planet Smashers, meh, seemed like a step backward from these type of games on the 7800 and 89 and 90. Sort of like a poor man's Galaga, except with boss creatures. I've beaten it a few times, but generally find it a poor vertical shooter. Sorry. Pluto's, had it been released, would have been a much better game of this type, in my opinion. Xevious, of course, is a classic in my books. Map Mania, not sure if I've kept the rule of five games, but Matt Mania is definitely trash. It's mildly amusing to go outside the ring and the graphics are decent, but the game really is not fun at all, in my opinion. Golden Wheel says Matt Mania for me is a meh game bordering on the trash territory. I consider Planet Smashers a solid game. Hard to shake the feeling it could have been so much better, though. And Lynx Pro says Matt Mania Challenge is pure trash. Doesn't even resemble the two arcade games it's based upon, those being Matt Mania and Mania Challenge. Terrible. Bass Guitari says Planet Smashers, solid minus. It's one of those titles that's good for a 7800 game, but doesn't really stack up to other games in the genre on rival consoles. Pros: colorful graphics, smooth animation, responsive controls, sort of a puzzle element with the warp keys, power-ups, reasonably challenging bosses. Cons: gets tedious, sprites look kind of generic, disappointingly limited power-ups. Matt Mania, can't comment because I never played it, but from what I've seen, it looks like it might fall somewhere between meh and trash. Retro Gamer 81081 says trash for Matt Mania Challenge. Complicated controls, no health meter to determine who's winning, hasn't aged well. Graphically, it's great, but not in terms of playability. Planet Smashers, meh. Terrible hit detection, enemies with moves that result in cheap hits or deaths, and a boss that is hard to beat. All in all, it's fun destroying the targets in your path. Save 2600 says both are trash for me. This is becoming a great episode. Planet Smashers looks and feels but sounds worse, like something we made as kids using shoot 'em up construction kit BITD. I'd rather play Body Slam on the Intellivision over Matt Mania any day. Wow, Jinx says both are trash. Ah, man, this episode is starting to reek. Trevor, Matt Mania Challenge, trash. It's pink versus blue. Wait, it's pink versus blue. Since we didn't emphasize blue usage enough, let's utilize both lighter and darker shades. Seriously, trunks, boots, ropes, crowd attire, pink and blue galore. The game has a lousy color scheme promoting high underutilization of the palette colors. What happens when the wrestler throws a blow? He becomes disproportional figure with a luchador head. Extra sloppy points for the additional boots, losing out their outline detail. Pulling off moves is a crapshoot. Background melody is minimal. On the plus side, despite the same pink-blue scheme for the clothing colors, the crowd does contain some good facial expressions and variety. I agree with you there. Sadly, it appears the variety was saved for the crowd faces only, as the wrestlers themselves are identical. The game looks like it is from generations ago, sounds like two generations before that, and plays like no wrestling game should. Planet Smashers, meh. Cool title screen with a 1990 copyright date. One may think maybe they're getting a game delivered with quality like Alien Brigade and Midnight Mutants and details and execution, but this one falls flat. Minimalistic shooter that feels and delivers like an early system first gen or beta release game. No background melody and the player ship firing. Admittedly, there is a bias experience here. Sounds like the split in two creatures coming down kamikaze style in Demon Attack for the 2600. There's nothing really, I didn't think about that. It does sound similar to that. There's nothing here to really keep a player engaged or interested. Overall, enemy and even the player ship design is very bland and simplistic. It's not absolutely horrible. Nonetheless, it can be overlooked with no great loss to the 7800 game collection. And Bass Guitari seconded that he'd rather play Body Slam on the Intellivision than most wrestling games. Now, if he only, could only get a copy, Intellivision Lives only goes so far. Gambler172 says both are trash for me. Sorry about that, Walter. And then Soulblazer, aka Greg from the SNE podcast, says, Matt Mania Challenge. This is the worst 7800 wrestling game, I think. The graphics and colors are muddy and not very well defined. Pulling off moves is very hard, and there seems to be some hit detection problems. It doesn't have any long-term replay value because all the issues. I do like some of the expressions of the wrestlers and the detail in the crowd, but this feels like a 2600 game. I have to check how many other games I've given trash stats to, but this one goes into that group for collectors only, rating trash. Planet Smashers, compared to the other people on here, I had a lot of fun with this one. True, the game does look and play simplistic in some areas compared to NES games that were coming out at the same time. However, it's solid, well put together. You know, and I'm sorry to interrupt you, Greg, but you know what else was coming out at the same time? Truxton and Thunder Force 2 on the Sega Genesis. Doesn't that just blow your mind? 1990. However, it's a solid, well-put-together game with some interesting twist on the space shooter idea, which was really old and dated by this point. Having to collect three crystals in the right colors to meet the boss is a cool feature, as in fact that your planet has a shield that you're trying to keep it from getting too low and by destroying asteroids, hence the name. I also prefer this game. Oh, and I forgot to say, after you beat up a boss, all these asteroids just blow up and you have to beat those before you move on to the next level. I've gotten about halfway through the game. I also prefer games that have a shield on your ship and the power-ups now. Sound effects are one of the weakest points of the game to me. Typical 2600 fare. I muted them. The game is a bit slow. Still, I'm going to go back to this one, rating solid. So, wow, there's some positive words from Greg. Let's go to the mailbag. You can email me your feedback at Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. That's Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. Welcome. I've got mail, and yes, I do. And if I look over any feedback, please let me know, because during my extended sleep in my sleep pod, I might have overlooked somebody, and I hope I didn't. Anyway, Lewis from Cool and Unusual Games on YouTube. Map Mania is a game I recently got in a lot of less common 7800 games. I haven't spent a lot of time with it, mostly because I'm just not into these kind of mashy wrestling games. But today I sat down with it and gave it a good go. What's there seems like a competent port. It's responsive, there's plenty of moves, and while I didn't find the controls all that intuitive, they didn't take long to get the hang of either. The graphics are good, and even though the music is off-key, I'm glad they took a stab at it. But that's about where the good points seem to end. It's very hard to keep your opponent pinned. Even after knocking them down dozens of times with a variety of punches and kicks to the head, they just get back up. This is where some kind of power bar would have been useful, I agree. So you'd know where your opponent was weakened enough. There was never any sense that characters were getting tired. It didn't seem like there was any strategy in pacing out moves to conserve energy. I also noticed that the computer would never climb over the ropes to fight you outside the ring, which is another letdown. I played on medium difficulty, maybe on hard? I don't think so. And honestly, I didn't notice a big difference between all the difficulties. It took me a while to pin the computer, but after a while, I don't know how I got to pinning him, and once I could pin him on easy, I could pin him on hard, and maybe it was just me, but it didn't seem like a big deal between the difficulties. It made up a little by being able to climb the posts and do moves off of them, but I was hoping for more. But perhaps my biggest letdown was how little personality the game had. Professional wrestling is about crazy characters, right? So why does Map Mania only have one generic character to fight? I could have overlooked, and he's the exact same opposite in different colored trunks. I could have overlooked some of the game's flaws if you fought different characters, each with their own fighting styles, but no. Without this, Map Mania on the 7800 just winds up being a bland wrestler. It's depressing. There are all these moves to do, but without any variety in the computer's fighting style, why bother? I wanted to give this game a solid because of the few elements that are there aren't bad, but due to it being such a dull, no-frills game, it's going to be a big meh for me instead. This game, sadly, doesn't live up to its cover art. Yeah, well, that's true. And again, like I said before, I wish you could take the graphics of Title Match Pro Wrestling and, you know, merge it with this, with the controls of this game, because the controls in Title Match was just unplayable. Let's see. What's up next? Oh, Duke of Hurl sent me a picture of some 7800 games from his from a gaming store he went to. So I will post it on Facebook later. Sorry I haven't got through to it sooner. I just today, which despite my long delay, I just got feedback from Andy for Map Mania. So he says, "Hey Phil, hey Andy. For some reason, I never send in feedback despite listening to every episode and playing Atari 7800 just about every day. Wow, I figured I should stop being lazy and actually contribute something. So here we go. Thank you so much, Andy. And if you're inspired like Andy, write in today to Atari7800podcast@AOL.com, even if it's on old games I already covered, because like I said, this show won't be lasting forever. We're coming near the end pretty soon. I acquired Map Mania Challenge a few weeks ago for a pretty good bargain. I'm in the process of collecting the entire library, and at this point I'm just over halfway. I actually just recently survived a scare with my 7800. When I came home with Map Mania Challenge that day, I took off the shrink wrap and put the cart in my 7800, and it wouldn't turn on. I fear the worst had happened. Thankfully, a new power supply from Atari Guide was all it needed, and now my lovely 7800 is up and running again. Oh, good. Being a huge fan of pro wrestling and the 7800, I had high hopes for Map Mania Challenge. Sadly, those hopes were not realized. Instead, Map Mania Challenge was one of the laziest, sloppiest, and amateurish games I've ever had the displeasure of playing. First of all, the grapple system. The most important part of any wrestling game is either actually non-existent or obtusely implemented. The game says that it occurs when two wrestlers are close together, but it never seems to trigger at any certain point. And 1 second I'll be punching the dude's face and he'll be dazed, and I'll go to grapple him only to get instantaneously slammed to the ground. What the heck? There seems to be no rhyme or reason for the timing with this mechanic. The wrestlers never sell moves either. They'll take a huge atomic drop and then get right back up like nothing ever happened. There's just no pace to the game. It's just a button mash. Hope for the best, button mash some more, and eventually turn off the system and play Food Fight instead. This game is so bad, it made me want to go insane, to go into insane Ric Flair mode. Woo! Rip my shirt off and proceed to repeatedly drop elbows on the Map Mania Challenge cartridge with a crazed look on my bloody face. That's great. And the music in the game. The worst digital monophonic drivel that my poor eardrums have ever been forced to endure. Someone clearly just programmed a long sequence of random notes and called it good, and a 3-year-old kid banging away on a $30 Casio keyboard would likely produce more audible. I'm sorry, I'm laughing and tripping over my words. More audibly pleasing sounds. Blah, blah, blah. The only thing I enjoy about this game, other than powering it off, is the cover art, which has a title in a cool, colorful font and features what appears to be a bulkier version of early 90s Shawn Michaels throwing a wicked flying forearm. I beg you to reconsider your rating scale here. Rating scale, as mere trash classification is not nearly enough to convey how truly cruddy this game is. Maybe Black Hole, where fun goes to die in a violent, horrible death. Yeah, that sounds good to me. Oh dear. Oh, and no feedback for Planet Smashers, as I have committed myself to only playing real carts on real hardware for the 7800 game, for 7800 games. Well, way to go. I applaud that. I've yet to pick up a copy of the game. The Atari 7800 is the only pure console gaming experience that I have yet to taint with emulation. However, despite never playing it, I'm fairly confident, assuming that it can't possibly be any worse than Map Mania Challenge. In retrospect, maybe it wasn't a coincidence that my power supply went out when I first tried to play it. Maybe my Atari 7800 was attempting to take its own life and spare itself to horror. Andy, thank you, Andy. That was a great first time submission. I enjoyed reading it, even if I kind of dribbled over it when I tried to pronounce all the words in it. But thank you very much for sending that. And to you, the listener, please send in your feedback just like Andy, because that's what makes this show good. All right, so I got a couple audio feedbacks in, and the first one is from Bill Kendrick of the Atari XCGS podcast. So he wants to talk about some Atari Party, and I'm more than glad to give him the floor. So Bill, the floor is yours.
Hey,
Phil.
It's Bill Kendrick from the XCGS Cart by Cart podcast. I want to let you and your listeners know that I'm hosting my 8th annual Atari Party this summer out here in Davis, California. That's near Sacramento and not far from the San Francisco Bay Area and Silicon Valley. It's free and will undoubtedly have at least one Atari
7800
set up. It's a one-day event on Saturday, July 30th. Visit newbreedsoftware.com/AtariParty for more info. Thanks.
Thanks, Bill, and random computer voice guy. Totally appreciate that. So if you're in the Sacramento, California area during that time, be sure to look him up. Next, it's time for everybody's favorite segment, Shinto Says. So let's see what Shinto has to say today.
I don't have much to say about Map Mania Challenge or Planet Smashers, since I don't own either. I do remember seeing Map Mania in the Radio Shack catalog, but it wasn't high on my list, so I never bought it, and I've never played it in emulation either. Not much interest in doing so. I don't remember seeing Planet Smashers in that catalog at Radio Shack, but this one at least I have played briefly in emulation on my PSP Go. It's alright, the presentation is nice. I'm a sucker for the sweeping asterisk effect to display text and the letters flying in from all over to build the words get ready. There's some nice parallax scrolling in the star field. Some of the enemies are interesting. The vaguely Starship Enterprise looking one is animated in a bizarre fashion. I liked the status bar at the bottom, though the position of the number of remaining ships and the score is inconsistent. I think it would have been better to have the labels on one row and the values on the other, not this mix-and-match presentation, but perhaps I've done a bit too much UI design, and how the game does it is good enough. I liked how there are power-ups here, but other than replenishing shields a little bit at a time, I didn't get much out of them. Couldn't figure out how to warp, either. Your ship's firing sound is annoying, but it's so Atari 2600-like that it's almost an anachronism here, and I like it for that reason. But it's still kind of annoying. If I had this game back when it was new, I probably would have gotten into it, but today I find it to be uninspiring, so I'm going to rate it meh. I'd much rather play Xevious. So that's the games for this episode. As I said, not much there, but I missed sending in an audio submission for the last episode, so I'd like to cover those games briefly as well. My brother played Tomcat F-14, it was his game, and I think he liked it a bit better than F-18 Hornet, but personally I don't care for either. Like Ferg, I'm not really into these early flight simulator games, so I won't venture a rating for this one. Hearing you talk about it, Phil, it does seem more interesting than F-18, but I think this cartridge will be staying in the 7800 game drawer for the foreseeable future. Super Skateboardin'. I don't remember where we bought this, but if I were to guess, I'd say it was Children's Palace, which was also known as Child World in various parts of the country. The game was not at all what we expected, but it was fun, the movement was fluid, timing the jumps just right was satisfying, and there was a bit of an exploration factor to it, going through the building and figuring out the correct path to take. My dad used to work in a big engineering facility with fabrication and stuff going on, so by skateboarding through this mixed-use industrial building in the game, it made me kind of feel like I was going through my dad's workplace, which I always loved to visit. His was a big flat facility, so none of those multi-floor pipes, but that still gave this game a bit of a personal connection. Just shutting everything off and making it out in time wasn't enough. We needed to find the quickest path through the building so that we hit every room exactly once, and we did, I'm pretty sure. I certainly don't remember it now, but at the time, either of us could tear through that building quickly and efficiently, and the high score binder bears that out. The fastest time, as recorded by my brother, is 14 minutes and 47 seconds. I don't have a date on that entry for some reason, but everything else on that page in the binder says early 1991, so I'd guess the time was around then as well. 14 minutes and 47 seconds. Looking at the chart in the manual, that is totally tubular, but way faster than the minimum threshold for that rating. What's better than totally tubular? Unquestionably tubular? Irrevocably tubular? Anyway, that's a really good score. I haven't played this game since the early 90s, since the word tubular existed in the American early teenage vernacular, and I have to say that I completely forgot about the in-game soundtrack. Hearing it in your latest episode really brought me back. Oh yeah, it did used to play that same loop over and over. I remember that now. We probably switched it off after a while as well. It gotta save energy, right? I'm going to rate this game a distant, nostalgic solid. The personal connection to my dad's place of work brings this out of meh territory, and my brother and I did have fun with it until we figured out the optimum path, after which there really wasn't much point in playing it. But the next time I have the 7800 out and I'm looking for something to play, I might pop in Super Skateboardin', and not F-18 or F-14 or whichever game that was.
That Shinto was bodaciously tubular. Way to rock it, dude. That was really cool. And actually, honestly, you did something. You know, you mentioned how the music brought you back and thinking of your dad's place and the nostalgia. Well, you triggered a nostalgia in me when you mentioned Children's Palace. Children's Palace, I know I bought, I think I might have bought some 2600 games, but that was more when I had the Genesis. And this was at a time right before they went out of business in my area. But when you brought up Children's Palace, that was like the store that you didn't go to, that was like the minor league of Toys R Us, right? Because Toys R Us was the big store, and then there was Children's Palace. But when you said that, it reminded me of a theme song. Now, a lot of people probably remember the Toys R Us theme song. I don't want to grow up, I'm a Toys R Us kid, there's a million toys from Toys R Us that I can play with. And if you're a gamer, you remember the part that went, from bikes to trains to video games, it's the greatest toy store there is, I don't want to grow up, because if I did, I wouldn't be a Toys R Us kid, right? And when you were doing that, it triggered the Children's Palace, and it's a commercial I can't even find on YouTube, but it was something like, Children's Palace, that's where it's at. You know, and they did like a thing where, Children, that's where it's at. Palace, we're back to back or something. I can't remember the words, but mentioning Children's Palace triggered that nostalgic thing in me. So it's just cool how these podcasts and stories can trigger memories. So thank you very much. And check out his podcast, the Atari Jaguar Game by Game podcast, which I think he's taking a little bit of break too as well. Sorry about that Phil effect there. Didn't mean that one, but you know, real life, right? But I heard good news. I think the Lynx cast is gearing up to come back somewhat soon from Christian. So that'll be cool too. So I understand how it is. So thank you very much, Shinto. That wraps up feedback. Remember, you can send your feedback on previously covered games or upcoming games to Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. That's Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. I'd really appreciate it. Send them in if you've been kind of like sitting on it, I'll do it someday. Do it now. Do it now. And because we got some interesting games coming up. Before I get to the upcoming games, let's see, I got to rate the game. So Map Mania, a lot of people trashed it, but I'm going to bump it up to a meh just because it controlled better than Title Match Pro Wrestling. Title Match Pro Wrestling was trash. I couldn't control it. This game actually could pin my opponent and it was somewhat competent. I could figure out a few things and do some wrestling moves. And I was a wrestling fan. I think there's five games I would rather not play than Map Mania, so I'll give it a meh. Planet Smashers, the more I played it, the more I enjoyed it, and it's going to get a solid. I find it very difficult. I can only get about halfway through, so I might have to do the invincibility trick to get to the end, but it's enjoyable. I wish there's more, diversity in the enemies, and personally, I wish it was a little bit easier, even on the easy mode, but Planet Smashers is solid to me. Map Mania, obviously you're not going to go out of your way for unless you're collecting every game for the system. Planet Smashers, I would say if you find a good deal on it, check it out. It's not one of these games where you have to overpay for it, and it does command a little bit more money. All right, so coming up in episode 28, we're going to do Sentinel and Ninja Golf. Now, Sentinel was PAL only in the European countries. So if you're from the other side of the pond, I'd like to hear your memories. I'm going to play the 2600 version and use that as a gauge because I don't emulate really. So I like to play all my games on cartridges. So we'll talk about Sentinel and Ninja Golf. I hope there's some Ninja Golf stories out there. And so be sure to send that in. After that, we'll do Meltdown and Scrapyard Dog. Episode 30 is going to be Basketball and Midnight Mutants. And let me tell you what's going to happen with episode 31. Here's what I want to do for episode 31. And please hold on to your feedback until we get there. Episode 31, I want it to be my Hall of Fame episode. And what I want to do, first of all, is just going to be a lot of listener feedback. So the length will depend a lot on you. But what I want to do is I'm going to go over my Hall of Fame games and my trash games. And I want to welcome you to do that. So this is, when we get to 31, this is a good time to sit back and be like, okay, I can only pick five games to go into Hall. Which five of them? Because if you're like me, you probably pick seven games to go in the Hall of Fame, and I want you to limit it to five. So tell me what five games will go to the Hall of Fame. Tell me what five games are going in the trash bin if you want to do that as well. And if you want to even rank them in order, maybe I'll try and figure it out and see and come up with a consensus of which games as a group we're deciding to put in the Hall of Fame. And you could put it, my number five game, my number four game. So your number one game will get more points than your number five game. So think about that now. I'll put that bug in your ear and we'll decide at the end of the episode which games will go in the Hall. And what's coming up after that? What's coming up with the homebrews? I will tell you next episode. That's right. You have to wait one more episode and I will let the cat out of the bag what's going to happen after episode 31. So there you go, guys. Let's see, member of the Retro Junkies Network, so be sure to check them out, and all the other Retro Junkies at theretrojunkies.com. I'm on Facebook, facebook.com/7800gamebygamepodcast. I'm also the No Swear Gamer on YouTube. I've been getting back to posting some videos, just posted a bunch of Atari 2600 video games. You can follow me on Twitter or Facebook as the No Swear Gamer. And I think that just about does it. Oh, if you want to catch me on another podcast, I was on the Retro League podcast just this past week as well. So you can catch me on the Retro League. I guested there a couple times. Very appreciative of those guys. They really helped inspire me to get into the whole video podcasting thing. So I think that's everything. So thanks for listening, guys. And remember, games are fun, but always keep first things first. I will catch you next time. Have a good one.
Yeah, I did notice that. So he's not only is he the No Swear Gamer, he's also the No Swear sender in of memories to other podcaster. Yep. So say that fast three times.
No Swear sender in of memories to other podcaster.
No Swear sender in of memories to other podcaster.
No Swear sender in of memories to other podcaster.